enthusiasm. Lord, may we not only sing the song, may we understand the song and let it speak to our hearts, Lord, as we worship you. We thank you. We praise you. In Jesus' name. And all of God's people said, amen. Amen. Remain standing for Brother Scott.
That you hear me.
Amen. Amen. You may be seated. Brother Bobby Hale and Brother Sammy, would you all come and help me? Go ahead and be preparing your communion sets, please. Thank you, Lord. Another safe Sunday. Yeah. You're getting pretty good. Are you getting good? Which one wants the bread or the bread? Doesn't matter. Don't matter. Bless the, Brother Sammy, will you bless the bread?
Let's pray. Most kind and gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for your many blessings you bestow on us each and every day, Father. And thank you for maintaining the shield around the Bland County concerning this virus, Father. We appreciate your blessings, Father, each and every day. Yes. And as we gather around this communion table, we'd ask that you would bless this bread as we partake of it this morning and remember that your body that was sacrificed so that we might have eternal life. In the name of Jesus we pray, amen.
Lord of grace, Heavenly Father, we come to this time of our service, Lord. It is just to honor you, Lord, that what you did for us, you took all the weight upon you. Like I said, the long walk you took, and you laid on the cross, as Brother Pete says, in his prayer sometimes, love helped you there. Yes. The nails didn't do a thing. And Lord, I just, it's unbelievable for the suffering you did for us.
Thank you, Lord.
And Lord, I just thank you, Lord, for what you did for us. So if we partake of the cup this morning, just remember the blood he shed for each one of us. That all we have to do is ask. And all the suffering he done and everything was sure worth it, you know, that he'd do that for us.
Yes.
And Lord, I just praise and thank you, Lord. And Lord, I ask it in Jesus' name, partake of this cup. Amen.
Please stand as Brother Charlie comes to lead us. Right after the service this morning, we're going to go down to the creek side. Three little boys want to be baptized. So if you want to go watch A.J., Mason, and Dalton be baptized, we'll just, right after the service, we get our clothes changed. We'll be doing that. So come down and share. And that anybody else that want to be baptized, let us know.
Like I say, good morning, everyone. I want to read this scripture before we sing this song. It says, there is none other name whereby we must be saved. Acts 4:12. There's something about that name. Jesus, 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 there is something about that name. Master, Savior, Jesus, like the fragrance after the rain. Jesus, 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 let all heaven know. she wrote over about, they say about 8,000 songs under different names, and it's no other than Fanny Crosby. Tell me the story of Jesus.
Okay, well, it is official. It is a little bit warm in here. Mindy don't have her coat. Mindy don't have her coat on. You got it, I know, but you ain't got it on. So it is a little warm. Do what? Yeah, but I figured it'd come off shortly. So we're looking forward to that when Rick's comes off. But sorry, there's just something wrong with the computer system that helps run the, I don't know. Just pray about that. We need some prayer. We need some help. We ain't got the right combination. Yeah, it's Do I? Well, it ain't feeling good to some of these ladies out here. We apologize. We worked on it. Cheryl's worked on it. On the computer system, her husband has been over. We've had another IT guy or two look at it, think about it, talk about it, remote in. So just pray about that. We get that fixed. So Chi-Chi, if you have a Chi-Chi name, she usually gives you a nickname once she gets to know you. So there is a gentleman in our church that I've never known her to change names. So his name used to be Pitchfork. That's a real sweet name, ain't it? Pitchfork. Yeah. I know. I'm getting ready to tell that because she don't change nicknames. Whether you like it, whether you don't, when you get it, you got it. And that's Rodney Ratliff's nickname, Pitchfork. You know what that means, right? Pitchfork? I'm not talking about pitch and hay, right? So she said he really didn't like that name. Well, guess what? He gets his name changed. Oh, he gets Handsome Junior. Now, ain't that cool? So anytime you see Rodney now, don't call him Pitchfork, but you can call him Handsome Junior. I think he sort of likes that. So that's pretty sweet story. Please stand as we get ready for our service. Jordan, I'm sorry, is that ready now? So be seated. It's showing, I couldn't see that, and I thought we were having problems, but I know you said. So I think we have a video from Guatemala for you. That's the bags of food that you help buy. You can't see them smile, but they're smiling. But you can see it in their eyes. That is the village that we're supporting, and that's when they distributed the food to them. So it's pretty awesome. You couldn't see their mouth, but you could see the smile in their eyes. And they said that has really helped those families there up on the mountain in the village. So thank you for your giving. Thank you for your adopting the village of Lost Canaan. And what an awesome thing. It's just... That's awesome. Amen. Let's thank the Lord for that. Okay, come on now. Woo! Y'all going to have to gear up a little bit. Amen. That's awesome. And you are doing it by your giving and by your adopting and your wanting to do. And we're ready to move forward with some of their projects and stuff, but they can't right now. So as soon as things open up there and some of those projects can go forward, they haven't confirmed it, but I believe the next thing that they really want help with is their church. Isn't that awesome? They want their pastor trained. They want to help their kids in making their schools better, and now they want help in the church. Listen, that's even before getting them better water. So what a priority. I would think clean. My first priority was water. But they're happy and okay with not having the best of water, but they want a better school for their children and their pastor be trained. I think that's just plumb awesome. He will. He'll make what water they have even better. So, and then wait until the time that the water can be run for them. So thank you. Thank you for your giving. You are making a difference. Like the little thing said, you are making a difference, making a great difference in that village, in that school. So thank you. Please stand. Philippians 1:20 is going to be our scripture when we get there. But let's repeat our church mission statement. Equipping our church body to love and to tell everybody about worshiping somebody. Jesus, who will save anybody. Amen. Philippians 1:20. According to my earnest expectation and my hope, that in nothing I shall be ashamed, but that with all boldness as always, so now also Christ shall be magnified in my body, whether it be by life or by death. For to me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. But if I live in the flesh, this is the fruit of my labor, yet what I shall choose I want not. For I am in a strait betwixt two, having a desire to depart and to be with Christ, which is far better. Nevertheless, to abide in the flesh is more needful for you. And having this confidence, I know that I shall abide and continue with you all for your furtherance and joy, faith, joy of faith, that your rejoicing may be more abundant in Jesus Christ for me by my coming to you again. Only let your conversation be as it becometh the gospel of Christ, that whether I come and see you or else be absent, I may hear of your affairs, that ye stand fast in one spirit, that with one mind, striving together for the fruit of the gospel, and in nothing terrified by your adversaries, which is to them an evident token of perdition, but to you of salvation, and that of God. For unto you it is given in the behalf of Christ, not only to believe on him, but also to suffer for his sake, having the same conflict which ye saw in me, and now here to be in me. Amen. Father, thank you for this letter to the church at Philippi. Lord, as we study it today, Lord, reveal to us. Lord, I just saw different words this morning, Lord, than I have all week, and I've read it many, many, many times over. Lord, and I just thank you. Lord, it is alive. Your word is well. And Lord, it will accomplish a purpose. Lord, maybe there's somebody here, Lord, that it will speak to in an amazing way. That is our prayer. Father, give us discernment, give us wisdom, give us knowledge of your word. We thank you for it today. In Jesus' name, and everyone said, amen. Amen. You may be seated. Thank you for standing for the reading of the word together. Verse 20, it says, according to my earnest expectation and my hope, that in nothing I shall be ashamed, but that with all boldness as always, so now also Christ shall be magnified in my body, whether it be by life or by death. So what's Paul saying here? His main thing, the main thing that he wants to do, his desire is that he would magnify Christ in his body, whether it be by life or whether it be by what? Death. So back in the day, he was a prisoner. Remember, we talked about that last week. He's in jail in Rome, in a Roman prison, not necessarily Rome, but he is in a Roman prison, and he is chained and shackled probably. He's probably in the inner prison because they've heard of how he can escape. He's an escaped artist. You did know that, right? Paul is an escaped artist? No. He just walks out when the Lord opens the doors, don't he? So they know of that, so they put him in the inner prison and lock him down and chain him up. And prisoners weren't valued in that day. You know, it wasn't nothing for them to, the emperor or whoever or wherever they were at, the mayor of the city, the judges, whatever, to go and just gather up a group of prisoners, because they wasn't nothing, and throw them in the den of lions to feed the lions. It wasn't nothing for them to bring out a Christian in those days and to burn them on a stake. Oh, listen to this, it's even worse. They would even dip them in tar and hang them on poles on the street and set them on fire for night lights. Can you imagine being a Roman and living under that oppression. People screaming. Oh, but then there's stories and tales of some that were martyred for the cause and they died singing. Whew. Paul could be one of those, couldn't he? Seems to be one of those people. Everybody can't do that, but you know, I would pray if my life would end some way like that, that I would not be screaming and squalling, but I'd be praising and thanking. But shoo, right. Somebody says, shoo, I don't even want to think about that. I don't even want to think about that being how it ends for me. Hey, whoo, I'm ready to go up in the sky when the Lord calls, right? And you need a ready rapture ready packet. And take it to your house. And put it in your bedroom. People will come and pilfer through. Don't you think people's going to come pilfer through your house when you're gone? And they'll find it. You put it somewhere where they can see it. And maybe they'll read it. And maybe they'll come to an understanding. Maybe they'll kneel down right there and give their life to the Lord. Now, they're going to have a hard time. It's going to be difficult. But the Bible seems to believe, I seem to believe, the Bible talks about they come out of the tribulation. So there's going to be some people who make it through. Even after the earth does not have any more Christians on it. There's going to be those wishy-washy Christians that will be left that thought they were okay, that aren't okay, and they'll be left behind. So there'll be some knowledge. There'll be some preachers who were wishy-washy, who didn't preach the Bible, who didn't tell the truth, who kind of sugarcoated everything. Listen, we can't sugarcoat anything. Because when we do that, then we're denying the truth. Help us, Lord. Help our church. Help the pulpit here, whether it's me or one of the other men or some visiting speaker. Help us always in our Sunday school classes. Let's teach the Bible. And excuse me. You know, I like book studies. I like James McDonald. I really do. I like what's the guy from Texas that does the book studies? Robert Morris? No. Robert Morris, is that right? What? Well, I don't think we've done one of his studies, but some of those book studies, but they're full of scripture. They don't just put their opinion in there. They expound upon the scripture that they're teaching on. So, but let's teach the Bible. Let's teach the things that are important. Let's teach the things that are important to God. Listen, if they're important to Him, they better be important to us. And He wouldn't have written it down for us if it wasn't important. Amen. So Paul's writing this letter and he's under a death threat at any time. He could be taken up, snatched up out of that prison and beheaded. He could be snatched up out of that prison and crucified. Jesus wasn't the only person that the Romans crucified. They were really good at crucifying people. Especially those that rose up against them. And you remember all that was part of the Sanhedrin and the Jewish leaders. That was part. Well, he's raising up a insurrection against Rome. So he was crucified. And Paul could have been. But you that come on Sunday night and we've been studying the book of Romans, man, it has been awesome. It has helped me a lot even as I prepare sermons, because as I was preparing a sermon out of Philippians, I remembered some things that we spoke about that the book of Romans teaches us about Paul. And what was Paul willing to do? He told his Roman readers, the book of Romans, he told them that he would rather die and see them saved. He also told them he would rather miss heaven if he would see his fellow men saved. Whew. How many in here would forfeit heaven if you knew X amount of people would all be saved? Boy, that'd be a tall thing to ask of us, wouldn't it? But listen, God doesn't ask that of us. He just asks us to what? Go tell His word. Go speak His word. When the door opens, just walk right on in. Listen, pray for the Lord to send you somebody. Pray for the Lord to send you somebody each day. And guess what? He will. He does. Opportunities will present themselves. And we just got to be what? Willing to talk. Willing to share what the Lord has done. But Paul, he was willing to die and die lost. He knew about heaven. He knew about the promises of heaven. And he called himself a bond servant. We've talked about that before. What's a bond servant? A bond servant is a servant because they want to be a servant. Some folks in those days were bought, and they were mistreated. And when their time come up to be released, they would run away from their master. But there was other people who were bought, and their master was good to them. And they were good to their master, and they loved their master. So when their time to come to be released, they wanted to stay. So then they would become a bond servant. They became a servant because they wanted to. Paul calls himself that often. Listen, he knows what he writes about then. In verse 21, it says, "For me to live is Christ, and to die is gain." So for him to live, he was going to present the gospel. You know, he's in prison, and he's writing a letter. And we're still reading it. "For me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. If he lives, he desires to magnify the Lord Jesus Christ. If he dies, he wants his death to magnify the Lord Jesus Christ also." Wouldn't the world be a better place if we all felt that same way? And if we all acted that same way? Okay. "But if I live in the flesh, this is the fruit of my labor. Yet what I shall choose, I want not. For I am in a strait betwixt two, having a desire to depart and to be with Christ, which is far better. Nevertheless, to abide in the flesh is more needful for you." So when I read that, even
for my
He was in a strait between two, having a desire to go, but also knowing it's needful for him to stay. But he was even willing to give that up. Listen, he was willing to give up a mansion that people would be saved. Listen, we should have that desire. We need a burden for the lost. I said, our church needs a burden for the lost. You need a burden for the lost. I need a greater burden for the lost. Listen, folks. Are we willing to say that we would rather die so that people would be saved? Are we willing to give up our home in heaven so that we would know that people would be saved? Well, that's a tall question, isn't it? But like I said, God hasn't called us to do that, but He has called us to be a witness and to tell those around us about His goodness in our life. What He's done for me, what He's done for you. And having this confidence, verse 25, I know that I should abide and continue with you all for your furtherance and joy of faith, that your rejoicing may be more abundant in Jesus Christ for me by my coming to you again. So here's those words, joy and rejoicing again. And we'll see them several times over the next few weeks. Listen, we need to work on our joy level. Boy, some of y'all look like you is happy, happy, happy. And some of you look like you is sad, sad, sad. And some of you, I can't tell because you got your masks on. Now, don't pull them up over your eyes and act like I don't think you're sleeping. We need to be the happiest people in the world. Listen, try to increase your joy. Don't worry. Be happy. Listen, you want to increase your joy? Quit worrying. Most of what we worry about don't happen anyway. Quit fretting. Quit wringing your hands and thinking about what could happen. And when nothing happens, what have you done? You've just cost yourself 2 days and three nights on your life because you've fretted and feared. God doesn't want us to fear. He wants us to be happy. He wants us to have joy. Listen, what did we read last week? The joy of the Lord is what? Our strength. You're all wore out and banged out and tired out and all this stuff. Get you some joy on. Brother Charlie, you ought to look back at this sad bunch sometime. There's some saddens up here, I'm telling you. But we have so much to be happy for. We have so much to be joyful over. But now listen here. When you finally make a decision one of these days to get your joy on, the devil's going to attack you for that. Because if he can keep you all mundane and just, you know, don't you like to be around somebody who's vibrant? Somebody told me this morning that I looked happier to them. And I thought, well, I feel better. So even in whether I thought I was doing it or not, I didn't know that because I wasn't feeling so well, I wasn't looking too good either. But I wasn't joyful. And they said, you weren't smiling. Do we think about that? Yeah, y'all think about it now because most of you are smiling. That's a good thing. Why? Because smiling brings you joy. Joy brings you to smiling. Hey, if you smile, your face won't crack. Do what? Who said? Huh? Just wrinkle. Yeah, you get them little things up there and down. Hey, if they see something on TV and they wipe that over your eyes in about 20 minutes, you better. You know the only problem? I think after about 20 minutes, it starts going the other way, and you got to put it on there again. And it's like $39.99 for a little bottle, so you're going to wear yourself out putting them on them things. So guess what? Just be happy with how you are and go on. I said, be happy how you are. You know, right there. Thank you, Lord. That's a lot of people's problems. We're not happy with ourselves. You want to be, if you're heavy, you want to be skinny. If you're skinny, you want to be heavier. If you have black hair, you want purple hair. If you got purple hair, you want blonde hair. Once you get that, you want it straight? No, I want it curled. No, I want it this way. Why? Because we're always searching and looking for things to make us feel better about ourselves. And listen, that comes from within. That's the joy of the Lord, is your strength. Now, if you need to lose weight to get healthier, as I do, well, then we need to do it. If you need to do this to be this, do that. But listen, do not do anything to make other people think better of you. Worry about what God thinks of you. And then remember that He says you are wonderfully made. You don't like how you look? Ooh, be careful. Why? Because God made you wonderful. Oh, now, I get it. I look in the mirror and this is not perfect. I don't care but how one person thinks I look. That's my wife. And beyond that, I don't care. Why? Because I don't care. I hope I look good to her. Can't imagine that, but she says that to me. So then why shouldn't I be happy? As long as she's happy, let it go. Amen? Amen. We don't have to look like listen, I don't want nothing to do with Hollywood. Those people out there are crazier than a bed bug. They don't know their way up. And then we put confidence in anything they've got to say, or in any opinion that they hold, or any product that they sell, or any body that they show. They're probably starving themselves to death. And I enjoy eating. I do too, Chi-Chi. And you know, and we try to make and mold ourselves to something that we're not because we think that that's what the world... Don't worry about what the world accepts. Worry about what God wants you to be. And be that. Be what God wants you to be. And glorify, just like Paul, glorify the Lord in your flesh. Be happy with who you are. Listen, I see some of you all smiling this morning. You ain't smiled in a long time. Be happy with who you are. Be happy with who the Lord made you. Be happy the shape that you are. Like I said, if for health reasons, that's different. But be happy. And worry more about your spouse. And if they're happy with you. Wow. Ooh, that got real quiet. If you are married, you do know you are supposed to worry more about that person than anybody else. Listen, mommies and daddies, if you don't pay attention to your spouse, you gotta raise children, you gotta help with your grandbabies and all that. But hey, and it gets hard. It gets to the place that you get so tired. Come bedtime, it's bedtime. But listen, we take time for everybody else. Sometimes we don't take time for those people who are the most special to us. And you know what? You don't have to mow that grass today. It'll be there tomorrow. Maybe a little bit higher than it was. May not be on the schedule. It may not be on the schedule. You may not get to wash that load of clothes tonight, ladies. You may not get to make for supper what you want to do because your husband's going to take you out. Ah! Go out on a date. What was that? Have you ever forgot what a date was? I don't know where all that's coming from. Coming from the Lord, I know. Listen, the promises to Abraham in the book of Genesis was to Abraham and his descendants. We are not a descendant of Abraham. But we are grafted in. We are what the Bible calls the book of Romans, a wild olive branch. That describes us pretty well, doesn't it? But the great thing is, we have been grafted in to the holy branch, which is attached to the holy root. And Jesus is the root. Praise the Lord. Listen, if we hadn't been grafted in, we'd been lost could be. No future. Yeah, we'd have a future. It'd be where? Hell would be our future. But God saw fit to graft us in and allow us to come in and be part of the family of God. And I'm so glad that He did. Verse 25, and having this confidence, I know that I shall abide and continue with all for the furtherance and joy of faith, that your rejoicing may be more abundant in Jesus Christ for me by my coming to you again. Listen, the reason we don't have joy is because we try to take everything in our lives and deal with it ourselves. And listen, look up here, 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 7. It says, casting all your care upon Him, what? He careth for you. Matthew 11, 28 through 30. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me. For I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is what? Why? Because He wants to carry your burden. He wants you to cast your care. He wants to be all that you will allow Him to be. Oh, Brother Paul, you don't understand. I can't do that. Jesus can't do that. I have a Greek word for that, and that is what? Baloney. Baloney. He can do it all. Cast your care. Allow Him. Talk to Him. Tell Him. Man, I've lost my blood monitor meter. Uh-oh. I mean, that's got my blood things on there forever. And I can't find it. And I've looked. And I can't find it. So I've been looking some more. And coming down the road this morning, it was like, well, why don't you pray? And I said out loud in my car, you idiot, Why didn't you pray first? Why did we wait? Why do we not call? Why do we not cast our care upon Him? He wants me to find my blood monitor thing. Yeah, I can borrow yours, but then that ain't going to be right because that's going to show up on your thing when you take it to the doctor and he plugs it into the computer. So pray that with me. I need to find my blood monitor. It's got a lot of information on it. It's got my insulin in it too. I got other insulin, but cast your care upon Him, for He cares for you. He wants what's best for you. Verse 27, only let your conversation be as it becometh the gospel of Christ, with whether I come and see you or else be absent. I may hear of your affairs, that ye stand fast in one spirit, with one mind, striving together for the faith of the gospel. So what's Paul saying? Church at Philippi, live your spiritual life so that whether he comes to them again or whether he's not able to see them again, he wants to hear of their goodness in the world. And you're thinking, well, what's that got to do with us? This is the question. Baston Union Church, what does the community of Baston hear about our affairs for the Lord? And in the communities that you live in, that we represent, how do they hear about the work of the Lord in this place? What do the people of Bland County hear about the work of God in this house? What do people of Bland County say about the work that the Lord is doing? Now see, I didn't say the work that we're doing, because the work that we're doing is the work that the Lord's doing. We're just helping Him do it. The Lord is giving out food boxes, although Linda and her group, her ministers, administer it. But it's God's pantry. It's called the Shepherd's Pantry. Amen? And it serves people. So what do the people of Bland County? It's not that we have to satisfy the talk of the county. That's not what I'm saying. What is our reputation in the Baston community and in Bland and in Rocky Gap and Ceres and Hollybrook and all the different places that you folks live? What do people there think about our church? When the church at Baston Union is mentioned, what remembrances does it bring to the people of our county? And I can give you a few because I've had them tell me. Here's one: that the church that loved my family when we needed help and they tried to meet that need. That's the church that teaches the Word of God without apologies. Number three, that's the church that gave my family food boxes for as long as we needed them until we got back on our feet. That's the church that does all those things with the young people. That's the church that gave my family things at Christmas one year when I could not have Christmas for my children. They bought gifts and they bought food. I thank you, Brother Scott. Praise be to God. Not praise be to the church, but praise be to God. Because God did all of these things and He used us, and you were willing to be used, and you continue to be willing to be used. Listen, folks, we work on those shoebox things. And there's stuff in your bulletin about it about every week. And you give so nicely. And those little shoe boxes are made, and then they're given to children. Children don't have anything. You don't know. I don't know. Who knows how that's going to reach people? Maybe that reaches a village. Maybe that reaches a group of people that don't know about Jesus. All that we do, we must go to further the kingdom of God and not the glory of a church. And I know you might think there and say, well, he said that many, many times before. And I need to remind them. We need to remind ourselves of that. It's not for our glory. Oh, everybody likes to be bragged on. Everybody likes to have good things said about them. And listen, you can be rude when you're passing the glory on to God too, so be careful. Your attitude toward it, your voice, your intonation, is that how you reflect your voice? What you say, what you emphasize on, what you de-emphasize on? So be careful how you do that. But if somebody brags on our church, pass it on. Pass it on up. Because listen, the Bible says, if he be lifted up, what will happen? He will draw all men unto him. We do not have the job of being the Holy Spirit. But a lot of us like to do that. We like to convict. We like to chastise. We like to do the things that the Holy Spirit does. Somebody in your life, and they're not saved, you don't need to be their Holy Spirit. You need to be praying for them and loving them. Oh, my goodness. Don't ever forget to love somebody. If you got somebody in your family, and I know a lot of you do, you have people in your family, and they're not doing what you want them to do. They're not pleasing you. They're not living a life that's pleasing to you. Don't condemn them all the time. Pray for them and love them. And give them a cake. I saw that unfold and happen before my very eyes this past week. And there was just very few in this room that know anything about it, but there was a situation where some folks who hadn't spoke to each other in years, they just so happened upon it. They just so happened upon each other. You know why they happened upon each other? Because one said it was this time, another said it was this time, another said it was this time, and nobody met at the right time. Because if we'd met at one person's right time, then they would have missed out on each other. If we'd gone on another person's right time, they would have missed each other. But you know what happened? So happened they were both at the same place. Now that is the right time. These folks had not spoken to each other in years. They ended up talking. They were even nice to each other, to a degree. And you know what ended up at the end? One person gave the other person the rest of their cake to take home. Now that was something to see, because I thought it was going to be a cane-raising time right there. And the Lord just intervened and eased it out and took care of it. Miraculously. Because if anything would have been done on our timing, the timing would have been wrong, and those two would have never been in the same room at the same time. Because they avoid each other like the plague. Do you have anybody you avoid like the plague? They avoid each other like the plague. But the Lord worked that out. And so if he can do that, he can do what? Anything. If he can do that, if he can orchestrate that, and woo! If he can, well, I'm going to go now. If he can do that, he can do anything. Amen. And it was awesome to sit there and see. And then the person said to me after that, said, I did give them the cake. Wow! I was about to jump. Before all that happened, I was a little bit aggravated. But when I saw all that getting ready to happen, I was a little bit nervous. Because I didn't know what was going to happen. But after it all happened and it was done and it was settled, it was awesome. Awesome. Sometimes our timing ain't right and all, yada, 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 yada. Listen, God wasn't worried about our timing. He was taking care of the timing. And it worked out wonderfully. Verse 28, and in nothing terrified by your adversaries, which is to them an advent token of perdition, but to you of salvation and that of God. For unto you is given in the behalf of Christ, not only to believe on him, but also to suffer for his sake, having the same conflict which you saw in me, now here to be in me. Listen, we are not to be terrified of our adversaries. You know, I don't know who we would classify as our enemy. I have some folks that don't like me for some things that's happened in the past or a decision that I made while I was on this board or that board or whatever I was doing. But they're not, I don't think, out trying to cause me any trouble. So I don't know of any enemies that I have, but listen, we have an enemy, church. It's the devil. He seeks to kill us. He seeks to destroy us. He seeks to tempt us. He puts trials in our ways. He calls sickness in our body. Listen, sickness is not from God. Don't never let nobody tell you that so-and-so got sick because of God. God don't put sickness on his children. I said, God don't put sickness on his children. It just don't happen. He loves us. He wants us to be all that we can be for him. But listen, we are not to be terrified of the devil. He is already defeated. What we have to do is put him in his place. When he comes knocking on your door, bind him in Jesus' name. When he comes messing with your mind, bind him in Jesus' name. When he comes messing with your tongue and he wants you to flap it a little bit more than you need to flap it, bind, use that tongue that you're getting ready to do some flapping with to bind it in Jesus' name. Oh, wait a minute. I ain't getting no amens on that one. I guess we're all guilty. I'm guilty. I say a little bit more than I should sometimes. But listen, the devil can use your tongue as much as he can use any part of your body. Oh, and it can do what? Set on fire little things. I don't know what's cooking, but boy, it sure does smell good. Is that Karen? Is that your class that's cooking? Must be, because I don't know nothing else cooking. It's a small member of our body, but it controls our whole life. Hey, if that's what you like to do, is get on the phone and gossip and talk about what's going on. Get you a new habit. Hello? Hello.
Hello.
Well, at least you'll answer me, Chi-Chi. Thank you. If we get on the phone and talk about everybody's everything and think that that's okay, listen, that's not okay. That's not what we're supposed to do. Let's finish with verse 29 and 30. For unto you it is given in the behalf of Christ not only to believe on him, but also to suffer for his sake, having the same conflict which you saw in me, and now here to be in me. So I understand Paul was talking to the Philippians, and he was warning them of persecution. And we are reading it today, and they're hearing these same verses. But listen, church, there may come a time, even in our country, that we might have to take a stand for the Lord. We might be. And we might even already see some persecution. There's churches during all this unrest and evil, this whole evilness. We've had churches that were burnt. Who's to say that they wouldn't come here one Sunday morning while we're all in here and surround the church and burn the church down? What are we going to do? What are we going to do? Kick and scream and yell and holler. Just like he did the four in the fire. If it's not our time, then we'll still be here after the fire is gone. We won't be hurt. We won't even have the smell of smoke. So maybe we need to crank up the organ as long as the electricity works and hit the piano just as hard as we can until the end and keep on going. Amen? The piano's going to burn up. Wow, that's a thought, isn't it? What would happen? Even in persecution, what? We need to praise the Lord. What if in the future people come to our homes and try to kill us because we're Christians? We may have to do what Paul writes to the Ephesians, Ephesians 6, 13 through 16. We're going to close with this. Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all to stand, what does verse 14 say? Stand therefore. I wanted to stop right there, but I can't stop right there because there's a comma. And it says, and having done all to stand, stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth, and having on the breastplate of righteousness, and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith we shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked. Having your loins girt with truth, and having the breastplate of righteousness, and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of what? Peace. The Bible tells us, as much as it lieth within you, what? Live at peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith we shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked. We can defeat the enemy, and even if we don't defeat him and he throws fiery darts at us, we will have a shield against those things in our life. Jesus is the shield. God is our Father. And the Holy Spirit envelops us all. Isn't that awesome? Father, we thank you. We thank you this morning for all your blessings. Thank you, Lord, for watching over us and guiding us and directing us and taking care of us. Lord, even when we don't recognize it, realize it, or know it, Lord, you are taking care of us and you are tending to us. And I thank you. So, Lord, thank you this morning. Lord, there might be somebody here this morning that recognizes their need for you. Lord, there might be somebody here this morning, they want to rededicate their life to you. Or there might be somebody here this morning, they just need to turn their joy over to you. There might be somebody here this morning, Lord, that just knows that they need to begin to praise and thank you for all the blessings of their life. And Father, help us. Help us, Lord, to find joy. Help us, Lord, to be accepting of ourselves. Help our self-esteem, Lord, to be increased in you. Not that we would become prideful. The Bible teaches against that. Not that we would become prideful, Father, but that we would be happy with who we are and who we are in you and how you created us. You created us all different. We're all different parts of a body, and we all have different things that we do, and we all do it a different way. Help us to be accepting of somebody else's way. Help us to be accepting of how somebody else does it. Father, you know, for me, that's hard because I have a way that I like things done. And then whenever somebody comes in and they have a different way, I have to hush and do it their way if they're the ones in charge. Help us to do that. Help us to do that without grumbling and complaining and murmuring. Help us just to do for you. And in doing for you, we're doing for others. And we thank you for that. Father, we give you praise this morning. Like I said, whatever the needs are today here, someone needs salvation, somebody needs rededication, or somebody might just need to come to the altar and kneel down and pray and seek you for more joy, for joy in their life, that they'd be happy. They wouldn't be fretting and worrying all the time. Philippians speaks of joy. Philippians speaks of rejoicing. Help us to rejoice in you. We thank you. Listen, if that's you and you have a need for salvation this morning, we lift this time and allow this time for you that you would pray this prayer of salvation. Dear Lord Jesus, I ask you to forgive me of my sins and save me. I believe you died on the cross to save me from my sins. I accept that this morning. Come into my life and be Lord of my life. I receive what you're speaking to my heart today, in Jesus' name. Heads bowed and eyes closed. Did anybody pray that prayer of salvation? Anybody in the entire church? Anybody at all? Father, thank you. I don't see any hands. Lord, you know hearts, and we thank you. Thank you for what may have transpired already here this morning in the heart of your people. We thank you. We give you praise and, Lord, and honor you today, in Jesus' name. Everyone say it. Amen. Please stand as Brother Charlie comes to lead you in a closing hymn. If you have a need for prayer, you want to come to the altar and pray, we invite you to do that this morning. Prayer requests from the internet. Lisa Taylor, pray for the first responders, EMT, fire, rescue, police, for protection during this time. Wow. I mean, not only from the virus, but from violence and all this stuff. Isn't it? It's crazy that we're attacking the police. We're attacking firefighters and all these things that we see. Lord, we don't need to talk about them, Lord, we need to pray for them. These situations, Lord, in our country. Satan, we bind you as you come against our firefighters, our policemen, our rescue squad, and all those folks that do the work of protecting and providing and being first responders. Lord, those on the front line, we sort of forgot them for a while, the doctors and the nurses and all those folks. Lord, they're there all the time and have cases of maybe this one has the virus, and maybe whatever. But Lord, protect them all. Keep them safe. Satan, we bind you as you come against all of this. God, may you just stop this virus. Lord, if it not be today, maybe tomorrow. Lord, that it would just be eradicated from our country. Those that are sick, Lord, would be healed. All these riots and all those things. But Father, we've got a responsibility in that. If we, your people who are called by your name, will humble ourselves and pray and seek your face, then you will hear from heaven and then you will heal their land. So maybe the problem is the Christians haven't gotten revived yet because they haven't repented. If there's anything in our lives, Lord, reveal to us and help us to pray and ask you to forgive us. And Father, then you cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And then you will hear our prayers and you will heal our land, is what the Bible says. So Father, help us as Christians to examine ourselves, Lord, and to see if there's anything that we need, Lord, to get closer to you, to be revived, Lord, for our country to be revived, for our churches, Lord, to be revived. But we have to start with ourselves. So Father, we thank you for that word today. Your word, it will not go forth and it will not return void. It will go forth and it will accomplish the purpose that was intended. So Father, we thank you. Thank you for this day. Thank you for this opportunity to worship you and praise you. We give you honor and glory in your house, Lord, and we thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. And all of God's people said, amen. If you want to come down to the park, we're going to be baptizing the boys in the creek.